So Fumiko, what I was thinking of, what I was going to ask you, was when we have so much success among, say, just take entrepreneurs, it sounded like you were raising the question of whether, that your research might be exploring the question of whether or not that success is because they're tried so often, they're put under pressure so often and have to solve so many problems. Partly by the way people react to them, partly by the problems they're given without any help, that they in a way toughen up to the difficulties of entrepreneurship? Or is it some natural advantage that comes to you through dyslexia itself? Am I asking it right?
Yes, and I think it comes from both. So the simple answer is it comes from both. So for example, I'll give you an example of one of the research that we've done fairly recently is on the topic of stealth dyslexia, which is the a term that the Eide's termed.
You came up with the term stealth dyslexia, and you explored it. But tell us what it is.
So would you like to explain, or do you want to?
Go ahead.
Yeah.
So stealth dyslexia is where you have dyslexic-like characteristics, so you have trouble reading and the other usual characteristics, but despite poor reading, you have average or superior ability to comprehend. So when I was studying children, what I noticed was when I was interacting with children, I would have them read passages and they would stumble over each word after word after word, and then after a paragraph, I would ask these questions about the paragraph, and some children were just amazing answering these questions, and I was just absolutely blown away. You would think that if they can't read, then they might use all their resources on reading, and they might not be able to comprehend. And so,
it's a difference between oral reading accuracy and reading comprehension.
So you can. That sounds like an anomaly. How can you have good comprehension if you had trouble reading it in the first place?
Yeah.
This is from your own reading of the text, you get better comprehension?
Well, I think this is another perfect example of the difference between the fine detail and the big picture processing. So these are students that when they try to identify individual words, they're quite inaccurate. But what we see, it's like the students don't definitely settle with surety on an individual word identification. It's as if they put up a sticky note. So they may say truck instead of trick, but they'll put a sticky note up there that says, truck may be trick. And if they get further along in the passage and they see something that may look like magician, then they'll go back later and they'll pull off the sticky that says truck, and now that goes back to trick. So at the end of it, they've taken in and used all the large contextual information, the context. They've been able to infer the gist or essence of the passage, and that's where the comprehension comes from.
So is it possible that pardon me?
I want to talk about our brain results too.
Well, let me just ask so I understand this part. Is the effort to put these are virtual sticky notes, the effort to put those sticky notes up there and understand the individual word, is that effort making them more able to see the whole picture and get better comprehension altogether, or do they just have a better ability to get comprehension?
So we think it's a little bit of both, and so what we see in these children is when we look at their brain scans, what's amazing that we see this really strong signal or increased gray matter in the region called temporal pole, which is the temple, which is the side of the brain, but it's at the very tip. And this region has been traditionally known as this top-down, contextual, higher-level language sort of region. And so it makes perfect sense that you use these kind of contextual sort of information to try to possibly interpret the brain results. It seems like they're using they have abundance in those patches of the gray matter that allows them to understand the context and use that information to kind of comprehend despite having poor reading. And when you look at the age effects, so we wanted to see if it's a chicken or egg, and we don't have really young children for this study, but what we did was looked at the age effects, and we see both. So they see from very young age, as young as we have data on, we see a difference between stealth dyslexic and and other comparison groups, but also it increases with age, meaning that you can train it also. It's there from the beginning in certain types of people, but you can also possibly train it where it develops over time.
Now, you're talking about training the comprehension or training the...
It's comprehension, contextual process.
Right. Oh, go ahead. No, go ahead, please. No.
I'm very excited when I talk about
it. That's good. That's great. That's wonderful.
The interesting thing is that we saw it bilaterally, and this is to complete speculation, so please don't go around and quarter me on this, but it's the right, we see it not just the left temporal pole, but on the right temporal pole. And the right temporal pole is traditionally known, if you look at lesion patients and other things, that it's very important for social context. So comprehension of not the linguistic context, but the more of the social context. And so people who have lesion in that region cannot understand the social cues and context. So I thought that was very interesting, and we haven't really explored it and see if there's any behavioral differences in these children, but it is very likely that there might be differences in the social context, contextual processing as well.